Daniel, thank you very much. Anna, as Daniel said, I'm Natalie Chernetska. I work as a head of business development at Terra Lab, which is a digital innovation hub focusing on data sharing and based in France. We are a spin-off of a French engineering school, IMT, and we are participants in EU Hub for Data project. So this is a session about technical challenges. And in fact, Anna provided a perfect introduction to this session with conclusion to her session. She said, how are we going to make data work? And so this session is really about the nuts and bolts of the data-driven innovation. And we have three very different speakers, which I'm going to briefly introduce. First, we are having Simon Dalmolen, who comes from Netherlands. He is the lead architect in TNO, and he's going to speak mainly about EU Hub for Data project. Then we are having Santiago Cáceres, who's a project manager in ITI, a reference ICT research center in Valencia, Spain. And he's going to speak about Data Ports project, which is building data platform for transportation and logistics, especially maritime transportation. And then we have Anna Maria Schleimer, who comes from Germany. She's a researcher in Fraunhofer. She's very active in international data spaces and very active in Gaia-X. And she's going to speak mainly about Gaia-X. So each speaker is having 10 minutes for their presentation. And then at the end, we are having Q&A session. So if you have questions to the speakers, please put them in the chat and I'm going to moderate the chat and then select the most relevant questions. Okay, so that's all from me. And I'm now going to give the floor to Simon Dalmolen from TNO. Simon, floor is yours.
Thank you, Natalie. I will share my screen, one moment. Do you see my screen? Just to check, double check.
Yes, we do.
Ah, great. Already a lot of being said about the Horizon or the Digital Europe program and the challenges we are lying ahead of us. And I think the EU Hubs for Data project is trying to address one or two of those puzzle pieces in the sense of helping the smaller and medium enterprises and of course also the bigger companies in earning more economic capacity and being more compatible to each other. And it's all about an answer for creating digital sovereignty. And those are also the challenges we're lying ahead of. So for example, when we zoom in on the EU Hubs for Data project itself, we as EU Hubs for Data, there are multiple digital innovation hubs, the so-called DIH. And within each DIH, it's always a regional hub. It's all kinds of digital services are being offered. For example, for specific SMEs or startups in a specific region, and they would like to sell their service in a positive sense of way to other European companies. And how can we do that? How can we address it? How can we create more scale? And this is where the EU Hubs for Data project come into play, is that you have, for example, individual DIHs, they have a specific offer, and how can a federated catalog, so a service of services, how can they be interoperable? So for example, when a German company would like to offer their service to the Spanish region or the other way around, or from Greece to the Netherlands, for example. And for the EU Hubs for Data, we're currently investing a lot of time, at least from my personal perspective at TNO, for the digital services. So DIH offer all kinds of data services or APIs, but it can also be all kinds of training and or other services. And how can we arrange it in such a manner that in each country where you would like to retrieve service or subscribe to a specific service or offer specific services, how can we do a one click and connect? So you get a plug and play for future DIH to join the federated catalog. So you're querying it once and you get all the information from the specific DIH from your service request. And that offers all kinds of challenges actually in detail, because for example, when you see all the initiatives that are currently being proposed, for example, on artificial intelligence, the specific communities regarding small and medium enterprises, for example, smart industry or logistics or mobility. Well, I think you can imagine that we having always an interoperability issue, and how can we address it? And then I have to be honest, I'm really happy with the European signal in the sense of, okay, we would like to create a single market for data. Already being not enough being said, of course, but I think this is a really great and clear signal that we're not specific nations or countries, but we're doing it together. And from the European Commission, there's guidance to how to address it. I think this is really important. This is also where the EU Hubs for Data gives an answer to the European Data Strategy and the AI strategy that's being published last year in February. Also, for example, when you see the technical challenge or actually the interoperable challenges, and it's also what Gardner also is mentioning, it's all about data. But currently, data is being set as the new gold. Okay, if it's the new gold, you also don't want to share it always under all conditions. So what you actually would like to do is share your data in a controlled manner, in a controlled ecosystem. And this is where also where the common European data spaces come into play. But how can we connect all those data spaces? And then we need artificial intelligence and semantics, the so-called ontologies and graphs, to be a bit more technical. And if you then see, okay, what are the current challenges also with other initiatives, for example, Gaia, Gaia X, and international data spaces, is that a lot of companies find it hard to retrieve the value out of data. So what is my data actually worth in money or in other stuff? It's hard to create transparency and to keep sovereignty of your own data, and also a lack of standards in ontologies. And then the EU Hubs for Data comes into play and say, well, we would like to offer a federated catalog where DIH can subscribe and can come and go via plug and play service, where specific digital services or data services can be sold to other DIHs or to other SMEs. And then you can imagine that you have all kinds of issues in the sense of interoperability. And together as a team, I think we're now making a really nice steps towards the first federated catalog. We also embrace other initiatives, for example, Gaia X. It's also about digital sovereignty. And so I'm really happy to make these steps, because what you see, and that's also below, in the past, we had the dominance of, or not in the past, but also currently, of a few providers. And what you actually would like to improve the earning capacity for the small and medium enterprises, because that should be the answer, I think, for Europe in helping the smaller and medium companies. However, a lot of regularity and regulations is required. So therefore, I'm really happy with the steps that are currently being made by the European Commission. For example, the Gaia X initiative, I would like to emphasize it only a short. I think Anna from Fraunhofer will emphasize it a bit more, but it's also about digital infrastructure. And one important thing is also that the Gaia X also focus on federated catalog. And it's actually more or less looking for the same initiative processes regarding interoperability on a specific DIH, for example, or on the federated scale, so a federation of federated services. And if you then go to the technical details, what kind of issues should we address from the start? So for example, security by design. Within the EU Hubs for Data, we try to do this for the digital services and for the data services by using international data spaces. It's an answer for setting up the European common data spaces. What you also should be aware of is privacy by design. I think a few of my colleagues within the EU Hubs for project will also emphasize this regarding the ethics, regarding the Data Governance Act. And of course, how can we create such a federated catalog? So it's an encouragement of federation of federated services. What kind of exchange mechanisms do we have? How should the deployment look like from a DIH perspective, but also from an SME perspective? How can I get services or or sell my services on a plug and play basis. And that's also why the usage friendliness is really important. At this moment, from a technical perspective, everything is an API, it's a so-called application programming interfaces. So where you can connect your mobile to or other types of software interfaces. And I think they should be offered in a federated catalog. And another important thing, also the machine processability, because also in the presentation from the European Commission, it was, for example, the dishwasher or the wash machine should communicate. Yeah, this is also an important thing for the services that are being offered in the federated catalog. And I think the most important part in the end is all about the semantics. How do we know that we speak the same language? The everything is being interoperable. And this is where the FAIR principle comes into play. It's called findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable. So you get not a lack of standards, but try to adopt the current standards and making them interoperable with each other. And this is also where the federated catalog comes into play as acting as a so-called yellow page. And so this comes in a pretty quick speed regarding the eHubs for Data project and what's currently being offered in the market and also the initiatives that are being done alongside within the countries and within Europe itself. So I think the eHubs for Data project is offering a unique puzzle, a piece of the puzzle in connecting the dots and helping the DIH to improve, not only looking on a regional scale, but also broader. And also from a customer perspective, how can we get service more quicker for my specific business? And I think that then the federated catalog can be a piece of the puzzle. And interoperability is everything in helping the small and medium enterprises. So this is really, in short, presentations for today. If you have specific technology questions regarding IDS or GIACS, I'm happy to answer them also offline. So so for this, I would like to give the floor back to you, Natalia.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Simon, for this presentation and for challenges that you outlined, both the challenges on general European level, obviously you mentioned interoperability, a huge issue, but also data infrastructure, which we are learning every day how important it is to build infrastructure. But also the challenges specific to this project, eHub for Data, like how we are building federated catalog, not just a catalog, right? How we make it user-friendly, and obviously semantics. I mean, we agree on that. So as you know, eHub for Data is a relatively recent project. We launched in September. And so it's always our pleasure to learn from other projects. So I'm thanking Simon for his presentation. And now we're going to give the floor to another speaker, Santiago Cáceres from ITI, who's going to speak about the project that I think 1 year old already, and it's about connecting European ports. So Santiago, please, the floor is yours.
Santiago, you're muted.
Santiago, please unmute yourself.
Yes, okay, now okay. I can
hear you. Now we see you and we hear you. Please go.
Perfect. Okay, so thank you very much, Natalie. And I would like also to thank you, the whole eHubs for Data team, for inviting Dataports to this talk. So what I'm going to give you in this very brief overview is the technical challenges that we are facing in the Dataports project. So I will introduce some of the challenges that we are facing. I will also introduce our technical solution, which is relying on several technologies you will see in a moment. And just I will conclude with some data challenges that I would like to highlight for discussion if you want later, okay? So first of all, I don't know how familiar you are with ports. I believe most of you have made use of some of them at some time, even a cruise or vessel or whatever. So if you think in a port, you have here the image of the port of Valencia. This is quite a complex environment. So there are many daily activities going on it. So it's activities regarding logistics. For example, in this port of Valencia, it has a huge container terminal You see all the containers that, they store that go goes in and out of the port constantly. There are also cruises that arrive, plenty of, passengers and so on. So at the end, we have a very complex environment, which is it's an ecosystem where lives lots of stakeholders that they collaborate each day. They are forced to collaborate because they have to share data one and another. And just to mention, you have there the port authority, shipping agencies, the terminal operator, the freight forwarder, and each one of them, they have their own systems in place. They manage their platforms. They may have some operators going around, and this generates a huge amount of data inside the port. Okay. Communication between the stakeholders always is not the best. Even if they share data, there are some challenges inside this ecosystem. So, for example, there is a lack of platforms and methods for secure and trusted sharing of data. There are gaps in interoperability and integration. So if you want to integrate one system of a shipping agency with a terminal operator, it may cost a lot of resources and monetary cost to do that. And connecting to the outside, to other data platforms outside the port, that is really difficult, both technically and operational, okay? Because sometimes we find out that, and it is logical, some companies and institutions are reluctant to share data because at the end, it is their know-how, okay? So there are many challenges in European seaports and where is, and this is why Dataports stands for. It's a data platform for the connection of cognitive ports. And what we are doing is just trying to take advantage of this huge amount of data generated in the port. And we create a data platform and a set of services where we combine all the data coming from the different entities, from the different assets in the port. And the final aim is to improve the existing processes and the existing operations in the port, okay? Of course, we rely on the top of the platform with applications. These are artificial intelligence based. So we use machine learning algorithms to make predictions, forecastings, to help in the planning of the logistics operations in the port, etc. And of course, if you introduce a new element in such a complex ecosystem, then you have to revisit your business model and your exploitation opportunities. So we are doing some research also there. Okay, so this is just for you to know the participants in Dataports. So this is a project coordinated by ITI. And you see there are a majority of partners coming from Spain and Greece. And that's because our pilots are in Valencia in Spain and in Thessaloniki in Greece, okay? So just to understand how the Dataports data platform works, I will put a concrete example so you can easily see how this may work. Okay, so just think, for example, we have two of these entities in the port that want to share some data, or it's needed some data about a container. Okay, so there are some entities interested in monitoring the location of a container, and we have the terminal operator, which has relevant information about that, and the container carrier. This will act as data providers, and they all both have in their own databases, in their own systems, instances of the data platforms installed there, okay? The one that is going to consume this data is the port authority. So they, for example, plan to publish this information in the port community system, which is the system that has access to all entities in the port, and to provide some services on the top of that. So they are going to process somehow this data and provide some services for the port community, okay? We may also have a third party here, which is an IT provider that is giving some analytics on all this data and will help with the processing of the information and to build these services. So they will also have some kind of platform instance in their own premises. So we keep here the premise of the data should remain the closer possible to their owner, okay? So this is all the Dataports data space, which is, we are relying in the IDS reference architectures, and we have built our architecture following the principles. And of course, we need some data governance rules, and we have to make sure we have a secure environment in place, okay? So I'm not going into details of the architecture, which is quite complex. And as I only have 10 minutes, I will just to give you some headlines and highlights about our current building blocks. So we have a set of what we call the services. These are in the bottom part of the architecture and I'm closer to the data sources. So these are the blocks that are in charge of extracting all the needed data from the data sources to transform it in a way that it's understandable for each one of the actors inside the Dataport data space. Thanks to some semantic interoperability, we also give the opportunity to use blockchain, not just as a data governance element, but also to share data in the blockchain, okay? And in relation with the data governance, what we are doing is to use a blockchain network. And one of the, I would say, most important element there is the smart contracts. We are using smart contracts for governance rules. So thanks to the smart contracts, we can say, who can access the data, how much time can be accessed the data, for what purpose, etc. Then, of course, we are building data analytics to build some models and to make some predictions, forecastings, etc. We also check processes, so we try to improve processes inside the port thanks to some algorithms. And on the top of that, we rely on an IDS connector to connect with the outside world, okay, with other actors, with other entities, even outside the port. So of course, all these layers are interconnected, are interrelated, and we are making use of the recently published data space connector for the part of the IDS. Okay, I know I'm being I am a little bit quick and fast, but if you have concrete answers, we can tackle it in the questions and answers session. Or later offline, I don't have any problem. So just these are the two ports and the two use cases that we have in the project. One is in Valencia and it has to deal directly with the container and goods tracking and transport operations. So this is very logistic, I would say, use case. Then we have the Thessaloniki port, which also we are delivering there some and data-driven application and dashboard for the port authorities to make some decisions in the port. And finally, we have what we call global use cases, which have the main aim of scale and make our solution visible outside these two ports and extend it to other European ports. And we are relying in the technology of a couple of partners. So just to finish my presentation, just highlight some challenges that we have found out in the project. So first of all, the data heterogeneity. So there is a wide array of information systems and data infrastructure using ports for regular business processes. And these are really different one from another in terms of a schema, a structure, in terms of quantity, in terms of velocity, etc. So we have to have technical mechanisms in place to translate all of this and to make this easy to use for all the people inside the platform, okay? One essential element in any data sharing and trading is providing security and making it a trustful platform for the users. If the platform is not trusted, no one is going to use it. So we have to put inside the mechanisms for everybody to be safe and to be to trust our platform and to guarantee a secure information flow between each one of the port's stakeholders. Okay. We are using blockchain for data trading. In our case, we are using it mostly for the data governance rules, but also we have the capabilities to publish data directly in the blockchain network. So this is a technology which is emerging in the transport and port domains. There are some initiatives already around. It's not just the report, but I believe more research is needed in terms of blockchain and what we can do with the network. And last but not least, we are aiming at the end to provide accurate cognitive services for the port. And we need a high amount of quality data to provide precise predictions. And these are sometimes not easy to have, or they are not available, and some more digitalization is needed. Okay. So with this, I just conclude my presentation, which I believe I was right in time. And that's it. If you have any question, I believe we can tackle it at the end of this panel. And also you can reach me offline. You have my email there, okay? Thank you very much. So Natalie.
Thank you very much, Santiago, for this very clear, very informative presentation. I really like the way you outline the problems around data in ports and the solutions that you are developing than the project data ports. And I think we in EUHub for Data really should look closely at what you are doing and sort of learning from your experience. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Natalie.
Now I'm going to give the floor to our third speaker. Our third speaker comes from Fraunhofer in Germany, and it's Anna Maria Schleimer, and she's going to speak mainly about Gaia X initiative. So Anna Maria, welcome, and the floor is yours.
Yes, thank you. I hope you can see my screen.
And yes, we can see your screen, thank you, and we can hear you, thank you.
Okay, great. So hello and welcome to my talk today in this panel. I'm very pleased to join the EU for Data Forum and look forward to present to you the technical barriers to cross-border EU data sharing. Great thanks also to the colleagues from TNO and Dataports who presented a lot of really interesting points beforehand. And yes, as you have heard before, my name is Anna Maria Schleimer. I'm working as a scientist at Fraunhofer ISST and I'm involved in the International Data Spaces Initiative and also on Gaia X, which is the project where I will focus on today. So first, we are going to have a general look at the issues for data sharing in ecosystems, and then we move forward to the more contemporary challenges for leveraging data, and we will see why data aggregation and data integration is of vital importance for the for European data ecosystems. And then finally, we move to the challenges, the technical challenges, and especially architecture requirements, and also can see what the concrete Gaia X design principles, services, or concrete technical elements are, how these challenges are tackled. So today we face several challenges that hinder the evolvement of ecosystems and therefore hamper the digital economy. As you've probably heard before, ecosystems enable value creation by loosely coupled autonomous actors by both cooperation and competition. This means that the willingness and the trust in data sharing mechanisms by each single actor is of vital importance for the whole ecosystem to emerge. So, but studies say that 57% of all companies worry about revealing valuable data, nearly 60% fear loss of control, and further inconsistent processes and systems are seen as a major obstacle. Additionally, there is a big fear that solutions or platforms will not reach a critical mass. All those aspects emerge as a driver, especially for IDSA, but are also present in Gaia X. So trust and security, sovereignty, interoperability, and the need for joint action present the core challenges and are the driver for concrete action steps. When we consider the data value chain as we know it, that ranges from data generation in the Internet of Things or today in the Internet of Everything, up to processing, storage, aggregation, and analysis to finally enable the data use that brings the innovation for business and society, we can see three big stations. In the first part, the data the data access layer, we already face a huge growth and large availability of intelligent devices and sensor devices. There are already 40 billion devices there, and they have an annual growth rate by 13%. Further, when we look on top on the service offerings, we can see that they also have a relatively stable maturity and availability to make nearly 830 billion euro market value by 2025. The critical part here is in the middle. And right in the middle between those two steps, it's the data platform. Data platforms have 100 billion US dollar market volume, but we can see that the market leader is a US-based hyperscaler. Therefore, the challenge to tackle is the platform layer to effectively capture the generated data in the lower layer and build a solid basis to enable the rich variety of service offerings. The data aggregation and integration via these federated platforms face some interesting challenges. As we have this 40 billion smart devices, which naturally occur federated in our world, this federation and decentralization presents the core challenge and core requirements. Out from that, for the Gaia-X architecture, three requirements emerged. The first is the sovereignty of data and services, meaning that owners or providers of data and services have the option to keep in full control and transparency about what happens to their assets and resources provided via Gaia-X. Special attention here is, of course, given to the EU data protection and data privacy regulations. A second aspect is portability. Portability means, as we have heard by data ports, we need the ability to transport data and services without changes, adoptions, or some adaptations also in quality or compliance level. So portability is a key requirement, especially in the cloud landscape, because in combination with sovereignty, it enables to switch providers and avoid lock-in or obtain different data assets according to own needs or maybe changing circumstances. Further, also interoperability is one of the key requirements. It adds to portability and is the ability of different systems and services to exchange information and to also understand the information provided by others. So all these requirements enable the ecosystem in technical means. To tackle these requirements, four design principles emerged. The first is federation, which means that Gaia-X specifies federated systems of autonomous entities tied together by a specific set of standards, frameworks, and rules. This means that we are having multiple elements like ecosystem participants, assets, resources, or even multiple ecosystems that all can communicate with each other and understand the same language, so to say. The principle of decentralization supports federation. It fits to the decentral design of our real world and means that we can have multiple distributed governance and architectural elements. So decentralization also creates trust. For example, we have not one single defined authority for identities or accreditation, but there may be, for example, different providers. The third point is openness, and openness means that Gaia-X wants to create an open ecosystem, and This means that everyone who adheres to the GAIA-X principles is welcome to participate in the community. The GAIA-X AISBL, the nonprofit organization that is the head of the GAIA-X initiatives, only strives to set up a minimal set of requirements to leave the ecosystem as open as possible. Yeah, the last point you can see is the aspect of transparency. And transparency does not only mean like sovereignty, a technical function or something like a monitoring function. It also refers to the governance and platform creation process. So the technical steering and roadmap is all done in public, and the technology choices are made in order to encourage those technologies that are collaboratively created and available under open source licenses. When we look at these principles, we can see how they are realized. In this picture, you see the famous GAIA-X, which was published by the German Federal Ministry of Economic Affairs in June 2020 and will be in the technical architecture, which will be updated soon. The core enabler for this federated data infrastructure lays in this in the middle, in the federation services. And at the right, I added some points that are a little bit more concrete. So as Simon also explained, we also have this federated catalog and identity mechanism, the sovereign data exchange part, and of course a compliance set. And they all together are set up to tie the ecosystem together. And when we look at data sharing, so this list is of course not exhaustive, it's just an example. We see that we have especially this common self-description scheme, semantic interoperability, the reuse of existing standards, and also very important, the ability to have a unique identification of the different elements in a decentralized world. Yes, and much more that are really the concrete solutions to tackle the three requirements of sovereignty, portability, and interoperability. As I said, the last GAIA-X architecture was from June 2020. There was a lot of rework, and the GAIA-X AISBL is set up as a formal organization now. And you can expect the next architecture document already soon in April 2021. And there will be the first implementation of the federation services available by September 2021. Further, there are also additional documents like an architecture of standards or a policy rules and compliancy document, which will also follow this summer. So this was a really brief overview about the key architecture requirements, and thank you, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much, Anna Maria, for this interesting insight and overview of GAIA-X project and its challenges. You know, GAIA-X project, obviously, many of us are involved directly, and all of us are watching with great interest this pan-European initiative. So now we are going to take a few questions, and then you are going to have a break. You know, we are running a bit short, so we will not take many questions, but there is one from the audience directly at Santiago. Santiago, be ready. So you mentioned in your presentation that you are using IDS Connector. And so the question is, what were the biggest challenges you faced for interconnection? And if you can
tell how much effort, approximately in person months or other units, you invested in using this connector. So please, Santiago.
Okay, thank you very much for the question. So I would say approximately we use 2-3 person months, but still we are looking to achieve this integration. Okay, so this is not really done. Most of it was to we were testing the trusted connector, the IDS trusted connector. I don't know if you are familiar with it, but due to the complexity required for the deployment, we discarded. So there was some effort there, and that was finally discarded. And we are looking now to the data space connector that was in my slide of the architecture. This seems to fit much better in our needs. Okay. Deploying this IDS connector is not a straightforward and not a trivial task, believe me. It's quite challenging. And the biggest challenge so far was to understand all the concepts and all the models around the IDS reference architecture. Okay. So we had many, many audio conference discussing about how to deploy this, how to make this a reality. Okay. So this is something that needs effort, and we are still on it.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Santiago. This was very relevant question, I think, for many of us. Quite a lot of us working with IDS architecture and working on these connectors, very valuable information. So as I said, we don't have much time, but I would like to ask just one final question to all the panelists. You know, this session is about technical challenges to data innovation in Europe, and they're obviously many and manifold, as you explained, you know, start on along the entire data value chain, starting from the fact that data is heterogeneous and ending with, you know, necessity to do security and privacy by design and developing data analytics. We also heard in the previous session that it's very difficult to predict the future. You know, that's quite clear, particularly in these days. Still, so if you had to choose only one challenge to solve within the next 3 years, what should it be? Only one challenge to data, technical challenge to data innovation in Europe to solve within the next 3 years. And I'll ask Simon and then Santiago and then Anna Maria. So Simon, please.
Yeah, thank you for this question. I think it's a really nice one in the sense of if I would like to address or solve one thing, and at this moment, we're technically capable of giving other people via the IDS connectors data access. I think the most important question is how can we retrieve data usage control? So for example, I give you my set of data and you're only allowed to use it for a specific analysis. So it will be transferred to you. You use it for that specific analysis. And how do I know for certain that there's not any misuse? I think that's the biggest challenge technically that we're for now for the next coming years.
Okay, thank you very much, Simon. Santiago?
Yes, I'm unmuted. So for me, the technical challenge is how can we provide trust to all the actors that want to use this database? With technically speaking, okay? So how, made by certification, standardization, interoperability mechanisms, I would like to know what is the right mechanisms to put there in place for people to trust our technical solutions. And that would be my main challenge, okay?
Thank you very much, Santiago. And Anna Maria?
Yes, I would directly also highlight the usage control thing, that we go away from just monitoring what happens, but really have a trust by being sure that we understand the systems and we can be sure that so we don't need so much monitoring because it's just technically enforced that only happens what we want. Additionally, I think that it's a challenge to have a big, so this big interoperability topic and the evolving landscape of standards, and some are open standards, but some are really just de facto standards or some best practices that result in a wide landscape and that need to be somehow interoperable and aligned.
thank you very much, Anna Maria, and thanks once again to all three speakers, Simon Delman from TNO, Santiago Cáceres from ITI, Anna Maria Schleimer from Fraunhofer. Unfortunately, we have to stop, although there are some questions, but you obviously are very welcome to get in touch with our speakers and they would be happy to answer your questions. So with that, this session on technical challenges is over.